Well, welcome to our service together. Welcome to Paulsgrove Baptist Church. And I know it's slightly strange worshipping like this at the time where we're not able to gather together as a group of people together. But I hope you enjoyed if you were able to tune in last week for our Lord's Supper celebration, a time of praising God and of remembering Christ and his sacrifice for us on the cross. And if you haven't been able to engage with that or listen to that, then that's still available on our YouTube channel. You can just search for it. But it's important actually for us to be able to connect like this, to be able to encourage and build each other up as church, and to be able to praise him through song, to hear from him through his word, to be empowered by the Holy Spirit's work in our lives. And we're going to be praying as well during this service, so we hope you enjoy it. If you if you've got younger children under 11, there'll be a certain point in the service when as normal you would have your children's groups, and those that are regular attenders of PBC, you will have been sent through some worksheets that your children can do based on their current teaching series. So if you are a parent of a younger child, you then have that choice of whether you pause the video and come back for the sermon and the teaching at a later time. But I'll leave it down to you as to how you want to go about things. I want us to read a psalm together as we begin. And the psalms are great because the psalms are prayers of those that have gone before us. And we can often resonate with other people's experiences because you know, whatever we're going through is not necessarily unique to us, but it might have been a common experience for others who have lived through them before. I'm going to read Psalm 57, a psalm of David when he fled from Saul in the cave, and think about what you can identify with from this psalm. Psalm 57, "Have mercy on me, my God, have mercy on me, for in you I take refuge. I will take refuge in the shadow of your wings until the disaster is past. I cry out to God Most High, to God who vindicates me. He sends from heaven and saves me, rebuking those who hotly pursue me. God sends forth his love and his faithfulness. I'm in the midst of lions. I'm forced to dwell among ravenous beasts, men whose teeth are spears and arrows, whose tongues are sharp swords. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be over all the earth. They spread a net for my feet. I was bowed down in my distress. They dug a pit in my path, but they have fallen into it themselves. My heart, O God, is steadfast. My heart is steadfast. I will sing and make music. Awake, my soul. Awake, harp and lyre. I will awaken the dawn. I will praise you, Lord, among the nations. I will sing of you among the peoples, for great is your love reaching to the heavens. Your faithfulness reaches to the skies. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be over all the earth." Let's pray together. Father God, we come to you today and we know that you are a God of mercy, a God whom we can take refuge in. And I pray, Lord, for your people today, that we might come to you and know your protection and your love and your faithfulness and your grace. We thank you, Lord, that you are the God Most High, and that we can cry out to you whatever we're feeling or thinking or struggling with, or whatever our emotion is today. Lord, we can come to you. We thank you that you are the one who sends from heaven and saves us, and that through Jesus we know that you have saved us and brought us close to you. We pray for any who don't know you yet, that that might be their experience too, of knowing a God, coming to know a God who is a saving God, and of whom we can know personally through our Lord Jesus Christ. And so, Lord, please take our time and our worship that we're going to give you today. We know that in our church we've had the joy of hearing of a birth from a family who've just had a baby. We rejoice together for that. But we also, through our wider church family connections, know of someone who has died as well. And we're grieving and sad for a life that's been lost. Lord, life is full of different experiences and emotions, but we bring them all to you now and ask for you to draw near to us, that we might be able to seek you and know your comfort as a loving and a good God. We thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to sing and praise God together now with a great song, which is Water You Turned Into Wine. It's a song about how God is truly greater than any other. We want to recognise that as we come and praise him, the God who is powerful and has shown his power through his Son, Jesus Christ. So let's sing this song, Water You Turned Into Wine.
Turned into wine, open the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you, none like you. Into the darkness you shine, out of the ashes we rise. There's no
Well, in our weekly services, I want to be able to give you some ideas, sort of helpful ideas of how you might be able to use the best, make the best use of your time at the moment. Easter is just a couple of weeks away. Cool, who'd have thought it? Time is racing, isn't it? And it's a good time right now to prepare ourselves for Easter. It might be that you want to take part of a gospel in the Bible and read through some of those verses leading up to Jesus' death on the cross and reflect on them and pray through them and what God might be saying to you about Christ's sacrifice. You might want to find a good devotional book that helps you with that. There are audio versions of those books online and in various places you can get free trials as well. You might want to buy something for you and your family to work through together. You might want to send Easter cards. You know, Easter cards, physical Easter cards, are not as common as Christmas cards. And so it's a great chance to encourage people or to reach friends who don't yet know Jesus by sending them an Easter card that they might be blessed through it. So make the most of these next couple of weeks and prepare yourselves and prepare your own heart for Easter. Something for families, if you've got younger children at home and you want to think about how you can invest in them for Christ, here's some good ways perhaps to do it. These little things are called devotional dippers, and this is how it works. In this little tub here, there's a set of three tubs. You take the top off, and with your child, you can just sort of take one of these little cardboard strips, and on them, you've got a different theme or a different word to think through. And so in here, you find your word. So this key word is baptize. There's some Bible verses, a couple of verses to look up in your Bible. And then as you've read it, there's like one question to think through that relates to it and one simple prayer to pray. These are really helpful because whether this is done around a table, whether it's done within family groups or just with individual children, it's a good way of just being able to learn some key truths about who God is and what Scripture tells us about Him. And you just stick that back in, turn it the other way up. There's a little tab there to show that you've read it and done that one already. And you start again the next day. This one is key Bible words. There's one on prayer, and there's another one which tells us about the character and nature of God. You can buy those from 10ofthose.com, and I think you can get all three for about 10 quid. If you're wanting to learn Bible verses and meditate on them, these are really, really great CDs. The Sing the Bible CDs by Randall Goodgame, because what he's done is he's put scripture to song. And so each of his songs on here are literally Bible verses that he's crafted into music, and they're really, really memorable. And whilst, you know, they're sort of written with children and families in mind, to be honest, when I'm in the car, sometimes I just have this CD on and I just love learning scripture and reminding myself about God's truths through these. So Sing the Bible CDs are really good. You can get these through, again, I think 10 of those as well. Through your prayers, you just see me promote the devotional dippers. But here's another way of dipping by praying, is by having sort of lolly stick prayers. And the way of this working is that you can write the names of people that you're praying for onto lolly sticks, or situations or things that you're praying for onto lolly sticks. And so as you want to be praying for things at the moment, you can take out your lolly stick and then be committing to God those people that are written on them. And it's a good job that I finished off my clotted cream shortbread to give myself a space to put my lolly sticks in. So there you go, there's some little ideas for you. Loads more as well. I'm sure you've been searching for ways that you can use your time really well to grow in Christ. But I just wanted to share those. There'll be some more next week as well. Let's spend a few minutes praying before we sing again. I think it'd be really good for us to pray and commit to the Lord the issues that are going on in our world and our country at the moment, and thinking about how we can seek God for His way forward. So let's just quiet our hearts and we're going to pray. Father God, we come to You. We've already read from the Psalm today that You are the God Most High, whom we can cry out to you for help. And Lord, we do cry out to you. We cry out to you with this current crisis that we're living in as in the world at the moment, and we ask for your help. Lord, we ask for your help for our government. For our government as they seek to make decisions, as world leaders are making decisions about how countries should work and how resources should be broken down and split up and used most wisely. We really pray for our Prime Minister at this time. Lord, it must be such a hard task. And so, Lord, we pray that you'd give all wisdom, that you would equip him and equip our leaders. Lord, you ask us to pray for our leaders, and so we do that now. Just praying that, Lord, you would use them in the way that they can govern the country to the very best of their ability. Lord, we thank you for our doctors and our nurses and our NHS. We give you thanks that we have this system and this provision in our country. And we pray, with all the pressure that's on them at the moment, we pray that you would use them and help them to be able to manage all of the people and all of their patients and care for people so well. We pray for those that are currently working on a vaccine for this virus, and all those developing ways that actually, Lord, we can be protected and looked after. We thank you so much for each one. We pray, Lord, for those who are struggling at the moment. Pray that those who are struggling, maybe they've been out of work or lost their job, struggling to make ends meet. We pray, Lord, that you would meet people's needs. We thank you that as a church ourselves and many churches around the country who are running food banks and providing for those that are struggling, we pray that you would help us to help others and to share the love of Christ through our words and through our works. So we really pray for those in need. We pray for each person in our country to have wisdom, Lord, in the way that we interact with people, that we'd be wise not to be mixing physically where that's not necessary or appropriate. We pray that we would all be responsible citizens. We pray for our church, Paulsgrove Baptist Church, but we also pray for the church in our country and across the world, that we would act in faith and not fear, that we would have hope and not despair, that, Lord, there would be growth, spiritual growth in our lives and not spiritual decline. We pray that you would use this for your glory. We pray that your glory would be known and be made known to the world, because you are a God, the God Most High, who can be known personally through your Son, Jesus Christ. And so we pray that many more people would come to know you through this time. And so we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we believe that God is a God of hope. And we're going to sing a song right now, coming to him as the one who is the voice of hope. And it's a song that starts off, as high as the heavens are above the earth, so high are your ways to mine. It also talks about how where there seems to be no way, God makes a way for us. So let's join and sing this song together, Voice of Hope.
As high as the heavens.
So at this point in our service would be the normal time when our children would go and leave for their groups. And as I said before, if you're a regular attendee at PBC, then your children's leaders will have sent you some sheets linking in with their current series. So parents, you can decide if you want to go and work with your children on those things and come back to the preach later. That's absolutely fine. But I'll leave that to you. We're going to come to our Bible reading in a moment, but we're going to continue with our series in Ezra. And I wonder if you're good at anticipating a plot line in a story. I wonder if you can work out, or if you're good at working out what happens next or how it will end. Maybe you pick up a book and you can tell where it's headed. When I go to the cinema, I'm just there to relax, to be honest, and so I regularly lose the storyline and I have to nudge my wife to sort of ask me what's going on so I can keep up with what's happening. Well, to be honest, that's if I don't fall asleep as soon as the lights go down. Of course, no cinema at the moment at all, is there? Maybe you're even interpreting or working out or predicting how this coronavirus story is going to pan out, what twists and turns there'll be along the way, and when and how it's all going to end. Well, our current series, our teaching series at PBC, is called Built for Worship, as we follow the storyline in the book of Ezra in the Old Testament. God's people, the Jews, have been graciously granted the opportunity by him to return to their land, having been in exile in Babylon because of their sin and their disobedience to him. They were to rebuild the temple in the capital city of Jerusalem so that they could worship their awesome God there once again. And for us, this story actually reflects the loving plan of God to build our lives for worship of him through Jesus Christ. Because God has returned us from exile. Having turned away from him, he brings us close through the death and resurrection of Jesus, wiping away our sin, giving us new hearts to worship him in every part of our lives. And in the last section of our story, 2 weeks ago, and have a look, check out our YouTube video for it that's still on our site. The title of our sermon that week was Opposition Works, from Ezra chapter 4. And we charted various examples of opposition, not just to the work of rebuilding the temple, but also other opposition to the rebuilding of the city over the years, during the reign of various kings, showing that there was a fairly constant flow of opposition to the work of God over the years. And so at the end of chapter 4, we read this. Thus the work on the house of God in Jerusalem came to a standstill until the second year of the reign of King Darius of Persia. That was a period of about 15 or 16 years. So let's read today where we're going next. And we're going to read from chapter 5, verse 1, through to chapter 6, verse 12. Get yourself a Bible, or have a look at the words that are going to come up on the screen. Chapter 5, verse 1 of Ezra. Now Haggai the prophet and Zechariah the prophet, a descendant of Iddo, prophesied to the Jews in Judah and Jerusalem in the name of the God of Israel who was over them. Then Zerubbabel son of Shealtiel and Joshua son of Jozadak set to work to rebuild the house of God in Jerusalem, and the prophets of God were with them supporting them. At that time Tattenai, governor of Trans-Euphrates, and Shethar-Bozenai and their associates went to them and asked, "Who authorized you to rebuild this temple and to finish it?" They also asked, "What are the names of those who are constructing this building?" But the eye of their God was watching over the elders of the Jews, and they were not stopped until a report could go to Darius and his written reply be received. This is a copy of the letter that Tattenai, governor of Trans-Euphrates, and Shethar-Bozenai and their associates, the officials of Trans-Euphrates, sent the king Darius. The report they sent him read as follows. To King Darius, cordial greetings. The king should know that we went to the district of Judah, to the temple of the great God. The people are building it with large stones and placing the timbers in the walls. The work is being carried on with diligence and is making rapid progress under their direction. We questioned the elders and asked them, "Who authorized you to rebuild this temple and to finish it?" We also asked them if their names so that we could write down the names of their leaders for your information.
This is the answer they gave us. We are the servants of the God of heaven and earth, and we are rebuilding the temple that was built many years ago, one that a great king of Israel built and finished. But because our ancestors angered the God of heaven, he gave them into the hands of Nebuchadnezzar, the Chaldean, king of Babylon, who destroyed this temple and deported the people to Babylon. However, in the first year of Cyrus, king of Babylon, King Cyrus issued a decree to build this house of God. He even removed from the temple of Babylon the gold and silver articles of the house of God, which Nebuchadnezzar had taken from the temple in Jerusalem and brought to the temple in Babylon. Then King Cyrus gave them to a man named Sheshbazzar, whom he had appointed governor, and he told him, "Take these articles and go and deposit them in the temple in Jerusalem, and rebuild the house of God on its site." So this Sheshbazzar came and laid the foundations of the house of God in Jerusalem. From that day to the present, it has been under construction, but it's not yet finished. Now, if it pleases the king, let a search be made in the royal archives of Babylon to see if King Cyrus did in fact issue a decree to rebuild this house of God in Jerusalem. Then let the king send us his decision in this matter. King Darius then issued an order, and they searched in the archives stored in the treasury at Babylon. A scroll was found in the citadel of Ecbatana in the province of Media, and this was written on it. Memorandum. In the first year of King Cyrus, the king issued a decree concerning the temple of God in Jerusalem. Let the temple be rebuilt as a place to present sacrifices, and let its foundations be laid. It is to be 60 cubits high and 60 cubits wide, with three courses of large stones and one of timber. The costs are to be paid by the royal treasury. Also, the gold and silver articles of the house of God, which Nebuchadnezzar took from the temple in Jerusalem and brought to Babylon, are to be returned to their places in the temple in Jerusalem. They are to be deposited in the house of God. Now then, Tattenai, governor of Trans-Euphrates, and Shethar-Bozenai, and you other officials of that province, stay away from there. Do not interfere with the work on the temple of God. Let the governor of the Jews and the Jewish elders rebuild this house of God on its site. Moreover, I hereby decree what you are to do for these elders of the Jews in the construction of this house of God. Their expenses are to be fully paid out of the royal treasury from the revenues of Trans-Euphrates, so that the work will not stop. Whatever is needed, young bulls, rams, male lambs for burnt offerings to the God of heaven, and wheat, salt, wine and olive oil, as requested by the priests in Jerusalem, must be given them daily without fail, so that they may offer sacrifices pleasing to the God of heaven and pray for the well-being of the king of his sons. Furthermore, I decree that if anyone defies this edict, a beam is to be pulled from their house and they are to be impaled on it. And for this crime, their house is to be made a pile of rubble. May God, who has caused his name to dwell there, overthrow any king or people who lifts a hand to change this decree or to destroy this temple in Jerusalem. I, Darius, have decreed it. Let it be carried out with diligence. So what we see is that the main parts of both chapter 4 and now chapter 5 include letters written to the Persian king of the time, Artaxerxes in chapter 4 and Darius now in chapter 5. The question is chapter 5 a case of déjà vu? Here we go again, another example of opposition against God and his people that seems to be effective. Last time, we saw that it seems that sometimes in life, opposition works. And we're meant to feel the pain of God's people when his ways seem to be obstructed. You know, it's not hard to hurt for them as we read these stories, those stories in chapter 4. Because we're also hurting in our day. When Christian speakers are publicly banned from preaching the Bible's design from God about his design for sexuality. Christians are not heard for voicing their concerns for the rights of the unborn as the government are proposing and heading in the direction of introducing more extreme abortion laws. Everyday Christians are seen as narrow-minded and are becoming more and more marginalised when all we really want to do is share the love of Jesus, even though it means pointing out that we're all sinners, but that we have a great Saviour. But here's the thing. Whilst the work of rebuilding the temple, the work of God, ground to a halt at the end of chapter 4, and that was the end of that story, it's not the end of the story. It's not the end of the rest of the Bible story itself, or even the end of the story of the book of Ezra. No. You know, this section is actually the second part of a two-parter. Last time we can wonder if there really is any hope for the one who trusts in the Lord. But this week we can see that of course there is. Opposition works. Oh no, it doesn't. We know by now that we have an enemy, the devil, who is a roaring lion looking to weaken and destroy the church. I want you to listen to these incredible words that were written by C.S. Lewis way back in 1942 that speak right into our times today. And these works in one of his writings contrast the intentions of the devil and the intentions of Jesus in their quotes. Here's Satan speaking now. I will cause anxiety, fear and panic. I will shut down business, schools, places of worship and sports events. I will cause economic turmoil. Sound familiar? Now listen to the words of Jesus. I will bring together neighbours and restore the family. I will help people slow down their lives and appreciate what really matters. I will teach my children to rely on me and not the world. I will teach my children to trust me and not their money and material resources. We have a wonderful, powerful, sovereign, almighty God whose plans always prevail. God could certainly use this world health crisis to actually achieve his purposes for the church and to grow his kingdom. You know, so many people are looking online, seeking hope and influence and looking for something to give them meaning. Let's pray that they find the truth about Jesus. Maybe that they find that through our channel, through our preaching and our teaching, or maybe through some other churches. But God can certainly be at work and is at work during this time. And I want to look at these verses in these passages, the section we've looked at today, to think about three ways that God actually can grow his kingdom that we can see here. And the first one is this: God's kingdom is built through the ministry of the word. We've noted already that the building work that began during the reign of King Cyrus stopped until the second year of the reign of King Darius. After Cyrus, his son Cambyses ruled. But then he was overthrown by Darius. Now, Darius wasn't of the same bloodline as Cyrus, so whilst he might have chosen not to follow Cyrus's rulings, actually the kings of Persia saw themselves as a continuous line, stretching back even before the Babylonian Empire came to power. And so what enabled the work on the temple rebuilding to restart again? Well, we clearly see from the first two verses of our passage that it happened because of the preaching of two prophets of the time, Haggai and Zechariah. Look at verse 1 with me. Haggai the prophet and Zechariah the prophet, a descendant of Iddo, prophesied to the Jews in Judah and Jerusalem in the name of the God of Israel, who was over them. Both Haggai and Zechariah have their own books in the Bible where some of their prophecies are recorded. And we see that some of them are spoken directly to Zerubbabel and Joshua, who are our key Jewish leaders in this rebuilding plan in the book of Ezra, and both of whom are at the forefront of restarting the building project again. And is it any wonder that Zerubbabel and Joshua were buoyed by the encouragement received by these prophets of God? Because as we look at some of those words from Zechariah himself, they can only have been really, really pumped as they took on board the words of God. Here's one from Zechariah chapter 4, where he says this. Zechariah says, "This is the word of the Lord to Zerubbabel, not by might, not by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord Almighty. What are you, mighty mountain? Before Zerubbabel, you will become level ground. Then he will bring out the capstone to shouts of God bless it! God bless it! And then again, in the following verses, Zechariah prophesies once more. The hands of Zerubbabel have laid the foundations of this temple. His hands will also complete it. Then you will know that the Lord Almighty has sent me to you. We can clearly see that the ministry of the word, preaching, teaching and proclaiming the word of God is crucial in building God's kingdom. We saw it in this story here. And during this time of impact of the coronavirus, the devil would love nothing more than Christians being weakened, than us stopping opening the Bible, than us stopping reminding ourselves of God's truth and us stopping listening to God's voice. But in fact, we're praying that during this time that it would cause us to grow in faith, to do more in our homes with our families, to teach each other and our children, to keep in touch with each other with scriptural truths, that actually we would grow during this time. And we as a church are going to continue to preach God's word and to post it online so that the name of Jesus will be lifted up in our hearts as we come to him by faith. Jesus promised that in him, God's kingdom comes close to us and it grows. And if you're watching now and you don't yet know Jesus personally as your saviour, I really encourage you. I would encourage you that you have an opportunity to turn from your sin, to recognise that you need a saviour, and to place your faith in Jesus to save your life and to bring you to God. And you know, even after this crisis is over, we will continue to preach the love of Jesus to a society who's becoming more hostile to the Christian message as our values diverge more and more from each other. We'll continue to proclaim the love of God through Christ. And for us, as Christians, as for the Jews back then, it is not by our might, it is not by our power, but it is by God's Spirit that anything will be achieved and everything will be achieved. So there you go. There's the first point for us from these verses. God's kingdom grows through the ministry of the word. But the second thing is this. God's kingdom is built through faithful and honest servants. In chapter 4, the two officials that wrote a letter to the king were Rehum and Shimshai. But here we're introduced to this chapter's officials, Tattenai and Shethar-Bozenai. In fact, Tattenai, as governor of the Trans-Euphrates, would have actually had a greater authority over the territory and the people than Rehum and Shimshai claimed to have had with their ulterior motive. And these officials in chapter 5 asked two questions. And here they are. In verse 3, they ask this. Who authorized you to rebuild this temple and to finish it? And then the second question in verse 4 is, what are the names of those who are constructing this building? Now, it would be natural for us to hear a particular tone in their questioning. We might assume that their approach is similar as the officials in chapter 4. We might think that they're being aggressive and deliberately difficult. But this wasn't necessarily the case. Darius, being a relatively new king, would have perhaps been wary of a rebuilding project in a city such as Jerusalem. So it would have been a natural thing for them to ask and inquire what was really going on here. And from the letter that follows, we can see that actually this is a very, very different situation from the account shown in chapter 4. And in any case, we should be so reassured by the comments both in verse 1 and verse 5. In verse 1, we read that it says the God of Israel was over them. And then in verse 5, we see the eye of their God was watching over the elders of the Jews. See, God hadn't forgotten. God could see. God was in charge. And he was looking after his people. We're next shown an official copy of the letter that they wrote to the king and how different it was than the letter we saw in chapter 4. It was simply factual and descriptive. You see, the reference to large stones in verse 8 isn't a scaremongering at all. It's not panicking. It's just simply stating what was in the temple building plan. The two questions that they asked of the Jewish leaders are accurately recorded, and they're not distorted in any way. And guess what? The Jews were actually allowed to reply, unlike chapter 4. And what they replied was recorded and relayed to the king. And it all seems very fair, doesn't it? Very different tone to this record and report. So why did the Jewish leaders simply answer the two questions very briefly? Why did they go into their whole story in their explanation? Well, the thing is, it was actually really important for them to explain their situation, the good, the bad, and the ugly, that they'd been given permission by King Cyrus to rebuild what had been destroyed and lost through their own wrongdoing, that it was their treasures that were being returned, that they had to explain the mechanism for the whole process. Maybe if you're at school, or if you remember being back at school, in your maths work, it's not simply enough just to show the answer to the question. The teacher wants you to explain your workings and to show how you got to that answer. It's important for the teacher to understand your process and how you got there, just as much as the answer itself. And for this authority figure, King Darius, it would add weight to the bare answers, to know how this situation had come about, so that he could understand the context of this project and why it was happening. Perhaps it would reassure this new king that the Jews were now displaying a growing humility as they learned from their past mistakes. For you, if you're a football fan, and a few months ago you would have seen the appointment of Jose Mourinho as the Tottenham manager. And in his first interview, having been appointed and put into that role, he explained how he'd taken that time between his last job and this one, reflecting on some of his past mistakes and some of those things that had gone wrong previously, and how he'd learned from them and was going to live and act differently now. In fact, from being the self-proclaimed special one, he was now stating that he was now the humble one. Well, time will tell as to whether that would be true for him. But in their explanation, the Jews aren't trying to influence the king in a negative way. In fact, we talked about confirmation bias in chapter 4, how actually the people writing this letter to the king were actually trying to point him in the direction of evidence that would only simply back up the point that they were making. Now, the Jews weren't trying to do that. In fact, it's the officials themselves, Tatanai and Shethar-Bozanai, who actually asked the king to search the royal archives. The Jewish leaders are simply, as we see in the words in verse 11, they're simply the servants of the God of heaven and earth. Oh, to be a servant, a faithful and honest servant of the God of heaven and earth, eh? If you are a Christian, if you're a follower of Jesus, then that is what you are. And that is what God wants you to be, a servant of the God of heaven and earth. You are his representative. You're his messenger. The Bible calls Christians ambassadors for Christ. We have a story to tell and a message to bring. And we don't embellish the story to make ourselves look good. No, in fact, we're honest about our weaknesses and our failings and the ways that we've messed up. Why? Well, we're honest about that in order that we could be faithful to proclaim God's amazing grace in Christ, his forgiveness to restore us, to worship him, and so that we can proclaim how good he is. Isn't that an incredible thing, that we are called to be servants of the God of heaven and earth? If you're a Christian, I want you to think, how is it that God might want you to be a servant of himself, a faithful and honest servant of him right now? How might you represent him in your families and in those that you're connecting with, to point people to the grace of God and the goodness of him through Jesus? Well, that's our second way that we've seen that God grows his kingdom, through faithful and honest servants. But it's the final thing from our passage here. God's kingdom is built through his providential rule over all things. We see that King Darius does in fact make a search in his archives. But what's interesting is that where the officials ask the king to search his records in Babylon, we see that he actually finds a scroll, in verse 2, we see, in the citadel of Ecbatana in the province of Media. Ecbatana was in the capital of Media, a province incorporated into the Persian Empire, and the king had a royal residence there. The king had archives kept to all of his residents, and so what this illustrates is that the king actually conducted a more thorough search than he was asked to do. Perhaps he searched through the archives in all of the places where he kept them. Not such a selective search as Artaxerxes in chapter 4. In fact, this was a very fair search and a very thorough search to find what had actually been decreed. Can you see? God was really watching over his people. And that's not all. The scroll that they found contained the decree from King Cyrus for the Jews to rebuild the temple in Jerusalem, for it to be paid for from the royal treasury, for his articles to be returned and placed in it, and for the Jews to use that building to worship their God once again. Wow. So what does King Darius do in response to this? Well, he not only honours King Cyrus's edict, but he protects and he extends it. He orders Tatanai and company to stay away from the building site and not to interfere with the project. In fact, they're also to help by providing whatever items are necessary for the Jews to sacrifice and to worship to their God, even though King Darius also wants a few prayers offered up for himself too. Darius offers protection as well, with a warning that anyone who gets in the way of this project will have their house smashed to the ground and they'll be impaled on a beam taken from it. Gruesome stuff, eh? We see in verse 12, Darius says, "I, Darius, have decreed it." But can you see that even though King Darius decreed it, actually, it was God who was at work, moving in his heart, in the same way that it was God moving in the heart of King Cyrus to kickstart this whole process in the first place. God's kingdom grows. Why? Because God grows it. It's his providential rule. God is at work. He's in charge, working through all circumstances to achieve his purposes. God isn't absent in his world. God is actively at work now, even now, in this world to achieve his purposes. So let's get this straight. Sometimes it might seem like opposition works, but ultimately we have to conclude that, oh no, it doesn't. Because nothing can defeat the God of heaven and earth. It's true in this story and it is true today. Let me share one last story with you. Very briefly, it's the story of Marzia and Maryam, who became followers of Jesus in Iran after a long search for truth and hope. When they found Jesus, their hearts grew for many in their homeland to come to know Jesus for themselves. And so they embarked on a mission which saw them give out over 20,000 New Testaments in Iran, with their lives being at risk. They were arrested and placed in some of the most horrible prisons, and they witnessed horrific things. But even during their time in prison, they shared the love and the good news about Jesus Christ, and they brought many to know Jesus for themselves, until the day that they were freed by the United Nations Amnesty International. And here's what they said after these events that happened to them in their lives about what they felt God was doing. They said this: God had a purpose. He wanted us to see that those injustices and to bring awareness about the situation of many people in Iran, especially women. We believe that it was God's plan for us to be in prison for those 9 months. We had great opportunities to share the message with many prisoners. Isn't that an amazing story? That actually God was at work providentially to extend his kingdom and to grow it even through tough times. Let us learn from them. that even through trials, God still wins, whether in this life or at the end of it. Nothing will ultimately defeat him. Praise God. Let us pray together. Father God, we thank you that as we hear the truth from your word, you speak to us in power, with your voice, speaking to our hearts by your Holy Spirit. We thank you, Lord, that you are building your kingdom by the ministry of your word, through faithful and honest servants, and through your providential rule. Thank you, God Most High, that we can trust you and that we might be built for worship through the name of Jesus Christ. We thank you. Amen. Well, we're going to sing again as we come towards the end of our service together. And this song is called God is Able, because God is able to do so much more than we ask or imagine. And if God is able to raise Jesus from the dead, as Jesus died for our sin and rose again, he is able to do anything in our lives as part of his purposes. So let's sing this song, God is Able, and let's praise him together.
So we've come to the end of our time of worship and our service for today. I hope you've enjoyed it. If you have a handout for the service, or you can download it from the website on the Sermon Centre page, you'll also have some questions for personal reflection or discussion over the coming week. And I really encourage you, as you go back through this message and try and reflect on it and think, what is God wanting me to do with this? Perhaps work through some of those questions and see how God is going to grow you for worship of Him at this time. So let me just pray for us, and we're going to close for today. God, we thank you for our time together today. We thank you for our worship of you. We thank you that you can still connect us together as your people through this means of media. And so we just want to praise you for every opportunity that we have to praise, to worship you, to seek you, to grow in you, and for you to be active in our lives. Help us, Lord, over this coming week to continue to look to you for everything and to commit our lives to you. We pray this all in Jesus' name.